right, Tom, I have to disclose this up front here. We are not
before
live.
Before we go live.
Right. Before we go live, I need to disclose up front. We are not live right now. Which is just you and I talking.
That's how it goes.
And I always value this time we have together, just you and I. Two people at the top of their intelligence and the peak of their lives. This is where, this reminds me of the old time salons they used to have, the ancient Greeks, you know?
You say the old time Solange, like Knowles?
You know, I haven't gotten to that chapter of the book yet. As far as I know it, it's salon. But now that
like a hair salon?
Like a hair salon. But the Greeks, they used to gather in the streets and they would just chat about whatever that was going on in their lives. And I feel like that's what we have before the show goes live. And I really value it. Just to give you a little insight into where I gathered this information, I want to tell you about a book that I've been reading.
Sure.
Can I do that?
Okay. Tell me about a book.
It's a wonderful book. It's called Subjectivity by Donald E. Hall. The New Critical Idiom. And this thing's great. I'm telling you. There's a whole chapter about Jacques Derrida and his theory of deference, which I've been just viewing the whole world through that lens.
Of deference?
The theory of deference.
Is that... Are you saying difference all French?
I'm saying the theory of deference in my English tongue.
So spell deference.
D-E-F-F-E-R-E-N-C-E.
Oh. All right.
And, you know, ever since I started reading this, I feel like my methodology by which I view this world, this mortal plane, has really shifted. I've appropriated a new lens by which to examine myself and the world around me and ultimately expanding my horizon of understanding.
So what does the theory state, this theory of deference?
The theory of deference is very simple. Essentially, we live in a world of icons and logos, and we have a something called the Dasein that lives inside of us and tells us words.
The Dasein?
Mm-hmm. The Dasein tells us words and teaches us things.
Okay.
And then we have to take what the Dasein tells us, according to Subjectivity by Donald E. Hall, and put it into these symbols and logos. And one of these symbols and logos is human words. So then when I say toothpick, let's say,
yep.
Toothpick is but a symbol. Toothpick doesn't mean anything, but what makes it mean something is when you've attached what it is to it.
I gotta stop you right there because toothpick, right? It says right in the name what it does already. Like, I don't have to assign meaning to it. Meaning's been assigned by whoever invented the toothpick.
Well, assigned arbitrarily, my dear boy. This is the whole theory of deference. For if the
If I call this like an eye pick instead,
right?
Or like a camera wood dowel, then it would be that.
No, my dear boy. For we live in a world of shared symbols, and if no one else out there uses eye pick to denote this, then we will have no idea what you're talking about, my boy.
The theory. This look, my eye has been covered by the pick. This is an eye pick now. I think we can agree. Well, now it's a mouth pick.
So what you are saying to me right now is you are amending the symbol for toothpick into eye pick?
Well, no, I'm just trying to. I'm trying to have a critical discussion with you and poke holes in your theory. Ain't that what the critics are supposed to do? I still don't think I understand.
No, my boy, this is exactly what I'm referring to. Postmodernism asks us to dig beneath the foundation. I've read all of it, and I'm very well versed in it. I can recite it by memory correctly off the top of my head, as you can tell. But what we just experienced right there is exactly what the ancient Greeks experienced in the salons. My boy. Oh. Isn't that great? After hundreds of years, now here we are, two men of science and culture, replicating the A-frames of the diachronic versus synchronic. Anyways.
I'm honored that you think I'm a man of science. And also, if that's what ancient Greeks were like, no shade, but exciting would not be the word that I would use, Michael. But, you know, to each their own, as a great person once said. Who said that? I'm going to look that up.
While you look that up,
to each their own.
While you do that, I am going to go live. So everything from here on out is on the program, and everyone can hear us and see us, okay? Are you aware of this?
It was invented by Merriam-Webster in 18... No, that's just what the webs... That's just where the dictionary definition's from. I might have to do a little bit more looking. Yeah, I'm going to hop out. Just bring me on whenever you need me to be on. I'm going to stop my video like you asked.
All right. Here we go. On three. One. Two.
Shakun, our son, Gout. You paint horses for courses. What?
Three. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the San Antonio Learning Annex TV. I am airing live here on your TV station, Channel 59. It's the 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time hour, which means you are watching eBay Power Selling 101 with Michael DeWitt. Tis me, the titular Michael DeWitt. I am an eBay expert. I am a power seller. I am the recipient of the 2011 Best Seminar Award. And I am overjoyed to have you join us here on this resplendent evening. As always, I am joined by one of my most deepest companions, my good friend, Tom Parrott.
It's Latin.
Latin for what?
Well, to each their own. It comes from a Latin phrase called sum cuique.
When you say Latin, you mean the ancient language?
Yeah, I mean the dead language.
And it says what it's a suite?
Sum cuique. Cuique.
Can you spell that for me?
S-U-U-M-C-U-I-Q-U-E. The phrase literally translates to each his own. Sum cuique. Okay.
Well, I've written it down in the margins of my book, Subjectivity, by Donald E. Hall.
Okay.
So I'm gonna add this now. This is officially part of this book. But if you are watching, you have no idea what we're talking about right now, because all of this happened before we were live. Right now, what you are interested in is learning about selling on eBay.com, the world's largest online marketplace. And we are going to teach you the lessons that we've accrued through our combined 127 years of knowledge.
Is that because of all the timelines that we subsumed?
Yes. Well, naturally, okay. Yes. We've existed in multiple timelines across time, synchronically.
And across Tom.
And across Tom. And on this evening, we are going to be joined by four students with items that they would like our appraisal of. And as I always say, before we do that, we do want to shed light on this week's Spotlight Charity. If you look here in the bottom right corner, you will see a URL, tinyurl.com/birthequity. This week, we are asking you to, rather than pay your registration fee for this class, we want you to donate this money to that URL below, which is the National Birth Equity Collaborative, which is an organization that seeks to optimize maternal and infant health for Black mothers and infants. Unfortunately, in this country, the quality of care given to Black mothers and infants pales in comparison to the quality given to, let's just say it, white people.
White people.
That's right. And this organization is helping sort of through education and through policy proposal. They're trying to bridge that gap. And we ask you, in lieu of your registration fees for this seminar, you donate to the organization using that URL there in the corner. You'll be taken to a form. We want you to choose the drop down on the form to the National Birth Equity Collective, or Collaboration, excuse me.
Then that's, you know, we're doing this, we're calling this seminar a labor of love, but we also want you to throw your love into giving the National Birth Equity Collaborative a little bit of your spare lying around. Cash, change, cryptocurrencies, traveler's checks.
That's right. If you've been watching this show for many weeks and you've applied our eBay knowledge and you've made a little bit of a change for yourself through the platform, we ask that you give a little bit of back towards each week's highlighted mm-hmm. organization.
You know, especially because playing eBay is kind of like playing an instrument. You know, you practice it and you play and then you become a power player. You know, let's talk about the greats like Dave Grohl or James Jimi Hendrix.
Carlos D of Interpol?
Yes. I'm an Interpol fan.
Really?
I think...
To this day.
I'll turn off the bright lights, but I'd turn off the bright lights, but then you can't see me. That's a little Interpol humor for you right there.
Those are some antics you're up to there, my boy.
Somebody making jokes. All right. Without further ado, let's go ahead and introduce some of our students who will be coming in and learning how to sell powerfully.
Yes, and I always forget to do this, but a resplendent hello to everyone who's joining us on the chat. I do see your messages.
Yes.
You are heard. You are seen.
Several people. Hello there. Dash Gash, Florida Man Gamer, Victor Crack Cobain, Fear Sauce. Carrot Flaver, Lucy is talking, Bethany and Marcus, and I'm sure more. Lester Pips, he came in and he did a guest spot at the Learner Annex. He had some Pecalypse tips.
Oh, yes, I did see the flyer. I do subscribe to the Penny Saver that gets sent around here, and
subscribe to the Penny Saver.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know you could. I thought you just got that off of. Out of the newsstand next to the coffee news, right by the bathrooms at the Riverwalk.
That may be true for some, but I do have to hound my mail person each day and remind them, please keep me on the Penny Saver list, or else, before I sneak back into my door, leaving an empty threat for them to fill with their own imagination.
Are you the reason the mail's been running so late around here? You've been demanding that they give you the Penny Saver.
Let's just say that I have snuck into the San Antonio post office and I have unplugged some of their monitors. Well, now, whether that has led to a delay in mail, I do not know. Speaking of a delay, we are so excited for our first student to join us this evening, Tom.
Yeah. All right. We got... Coming to us right now, first up, say hello, everybody, to Vanessa. Vanessa.
Hi, guys.
Good evening, Vanessa. It is a pleasure to have you on our seminar live on Learning Annex TV here in San Antonio on Channel 59.
Thank you for having me.
We're real thrilled. Vanessa, you look a little sleepy. What? Are you in our time zone? Or are you up real late somewhere?
Oh, no. It's, I haven't been sleeping lately.
Oh, no. May I ask what is amiss that has caused this crank in your sleeping schedule?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it goes into what I want to show you guys today, but my boyfriend brought this doll home, and just ever since he brought it home, weird stuff's been happening.
I love a weird doll.
Interesting.
What? Okay.
Now, explain what we're seeing here on screen, Vanessa, please.
And also, yeah, can we get a body shot of that doll? Can we go, like, full? a little bit. Give me the toes.
It doesn't have to.
Oh, it doesn't have to. Lord. Silly me. It's a half doll. It's been bisected.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's had a bisectomy?
It's circumcised, too.
That's crazy that you know that, given that there's already no bottom half to the doll.
I don't know. I have dreams about it. It tells me things in my dreams. I don't know. I need to get it out. It's...
Well, Vanessa, I'm going to ask you to take a deep breath in. You are in capable hands here. Tom and I, on top of being instructors of a learning addict seminar here in San Antonio, are very experienced demon and ghost excisers, thanks to this very seminar, funnily enough. What you have there is a cursed doll, half of a cursed doll.
Did I see it had, oh.
What?
Do not move, dear.
Don't move.
You can move now.
Okay.
That was a close call. I thought my eyes have besmirched me, but it appears they have besmirched me. Continue.
I don't remember. I'm sorry.
I forgive you. You were saying that you want to get rid of this cursed item. You want to find a fall man or woman to take on. Ooh, do not move. Oh.
What?
From my eyes. Was that some kind of silverware there, dangling from its tonsils?
It looks like a fork.
What are you guys talking about?
You are in the middle of an active haunting, my dear.
Where did you acquire this doll?
Great question.
My boyfriend bought it, and then he went on a very long trip.
By ferry boat? What was the mode of transport that he went on once he left?
Bus.
Hold on. Vanessa,
yeah.
I want you to very carefully lift up your right hand and then wave it around behind you a little bit. Okay. Just a precaution. Just wanted to take a precautionary measure there. I'm a little concerned.
What's going on?
We are seeing some kind of spectral visual disturbance. In the background there? Oh, no. Do not
move.
That one
actually looks kind of all right. Like, I'd be all right if there was some sort of a...
That was a helpful...
A helpful
doll.
That
one seemed more helpful. Like, if you've...
You guys don't...
Oh, my... Were you just sprayed in the face with Lysol bleach?
Was that what it was? This doll bullies me, okay? My bras are in the freezer the other day. I pissed in bed the other night.
Oh, no, my...
Did they put your hand in a cup of water?
I thought that was a trick.
I never thought that worked. I thought that was like a Lindsay Lohan Parent Trap level prank.
When I was in college, we didn't even try the hand in water. We stuck to the classic Lysol bleach in the face prank. It's a lot more consistent as far as effectiveness.
Okay, Vanessa, did your boyfriend, he vanished?
Yeah.
Did he?
Well, he's working.
What does he do for work?
He doesn't tell me.
What are you drinking right now? Don't drink that. What is that?
I just found a cup of it.
Now let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
My Lord. This is worse than I thought, Tom. Normally we have descriptions of cursed items. We've never actually seen the cursed item actively engaged.
Here's how you power cell. What is that?
Was what?
Oh! Ow! Are you okay?
We got hit by a frying pan.
Is that what it was? It was a light tap.
It looked like a frying pan.
I don't feel in danger, but I feel very insecure.
Why don't you feel in danger? This is dangerous stuff. There's a cup of mysterious liquid that you're drinking.
It's good. It's sweet and has no scent.
They make Windex with no scent? Fascinating.
The best part about this, honestly, is if you're trying to sell it, you know, most of the time when you're selling cursed dolls on eBay, like, I got a listing right here for an estate vintage leather / wood haunted string puppet named Marco. All right? He looks like he's some sort of a vacationing puppet. He's got a festive shirt. You know, he's got on sandals that look like Chacos.
Almost narrowly evaded. Huh. Wait, what is it?
That? Have one. And mysteriously one day.
Wait, is that also a haunted doll?
I don't think it's haunted. I think the other doll is jealous.
No, no, no. Tom, that's not a haunted doll. That's the Elijah Wood of the pairing. The good one. That's the good doll. The Elijah Wood.
I'm not familiar with a lot of Elijah Wood.
Oh, be careful there.
Productions.
Oh, please.
Does that make the other doll Samwise or Sauron?
Please, Vanessa, do not die as I'm trying to explain my Elijah Wood reference. Please, will you promise me to stay alive?
You guys seem busy right now, okay?
Michael has a really long explanation to give. If you die during that, we may never be able to help you out.
Elijah Wood was the good son in the titular film, The Good Son. Macaulay Culkin was the bad son, which would be this puppet here. And I want you to try something that's beyond anything we've ever asked anyone to do. So we understand if there's trepidation or hesitancy.
It's right behind you again, Vanessa.
Someone in the chat by the name Dash Gash says, this is some R.L. Stine stuff. Which
and
gave
they
me
also,
an idea. Huh?
They also referenced The Good Son before you even started talking about it.
I came up with that pool on my own. He said it after I said it.
I believe that. I think that that's the thing. I think they understood your reference. I just am not familiar.
Oh, you're saying before I let the cat out of the bag as to what my reference was. That is neither here nor there. I'm going to ask you.
They're in the same boat as you.
Vanessa.
Yeah.
I want you to slowly turn around and whisper a positive affirmation.
Aspiration or affirmation?
Why not both?
Both.
Okay. I want to be a dreamer and... What was the other one?
An affirmation.
Affirmation.
Oh no! It's too late.
Uh oh.
I thought I could. I thought I could use what was used against the evil sponge in Goosebumps, which died when you gave it compliments. But I was too late.
Well, we are out of time for Vanessa, and I think Vanessa is also dead. Question mark. If anyone knows where Vanessa lives, who's watching the channel. I did not recognize that domicile from the inside. I usually don't recognize places from the inside, given that I've not been inside a lot of houses or apartment buildings. But someone go perform a wellness check and also sell that doll for hard cash using that video in your description. That's power selling tip number one. Prove that you can that you have a haunted doll.
That was terrifying.
And that's... best guess number one, Michael. So I have no idea what to expect.
We've started this on such an infernal note that I shudder at the mere suggestion of what our next student can bring us.
We have a lot of people saying that the chat is haunted. We have people saying that that was Fear Sauce, saying that was Lil Marco. Also suggests don't drink loose cups. Victor Crack Cobain said that was scary AF. And Florida Man Gamer threw in three. It looks like that's you, actually. Three of your faces that have been animated.
They've posted a photograph of me in the chat.
Well, they're not photographs. You know what an emoji is?
That is not me, my boy.
It looks like you. It's like you, but with no glasses. Take your glasses off and do that pose.
Hold on. Let me get close enough to see what this is here.
It's a Florida Man Gamer. I think you got... Open your mouth a little bit wider. Yeah, that's you.
I have nary posed for such a project of... emojifying myself, but
maybe
I will give you that there does bear a vague resemblance.
That's just fan art. Well, shout out to Vanessa and shout out to our next guest. Are we ready for our next guest, Michael?
We are.
Well, say hello to our next student, George R. R. Martin.
Hello, thank you for having me. Yes, I'm George R. R. Martin.
The George R. R. Martin, the Game of Thrones guy.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, I did write. I wrote the Game of Thrones. I wrote the Winds of Winter. I wrote all the books in between.
Can I announce a fact about your books that a lot of people don't know?
Sure.
Okay.
I guess. I don't know. Well, I don't want to speak for you, George. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay with me as well. If it's okay with Tom Perrott, it's okay with me.
The name of the books is not Game of Thrones. In fact, the name of the series is Fire and Ice.
A Song of Ice and Fire. That's right. But the first book is A Game of Thrones. So, you know, everyone who's wrong is also right, which is nice because I just want everyone to be happy, you know.
Well, that is also our primary directive here on Power Selling 101. We'd like for you to be happy, and we'd also like to welcome you without a fact and say hello. And what can we do for you this evening, Mr. Martin?
Yeah, George, what do you got to sell?
Well, I'm selling, this here is the only printed copy of the current version of Winds of Winter. And I'm selling it because I have to change it because people didn't like it when it came out on TV. So I'm redoing it completely. I'm starting over from scratch. So I'm going to sell this version. Anybody can have the original version of the Winds of Winter, the first copy, only copy. And then I'm going to write a new, whole new thing.
First copy, only copy.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my Lord. And you've chosen eBay naturally as it's the number one marketplace on the planet known as Earth. But why exactly have you chosen our seminar? I'm curious. This is such a great exclusive.
You know, it is an exclusive, but at the same time, I feel like, you know, I didn't come from being a millionaire TV producer guy. When I started, I was just a young man with ideas, you know. I left Hollywood. I came to my place in New Mexico, and I started writing a book that people ended up liking, you know. And I like to support the idea of people who maybe aren't, like, at the top of the game becoming at the top of the game, and that could be you guys.
You were a young man when you started?
Well, you know, younger.
How old were you when you started? Because I see, you look great for 71. I'll tell you that much right now, but...
Thank you. Yeah, I've dyed the beard and the hair. Yeah.
Wow.
But yeah, when I started writing Game of Thrones, the first one, that was in the 90s, so I was around 40 at the time.
That's young.
It is. Yeah, it's younger than 70. That's for sure true.
Absolutely younger. I can't imagine. I mean, you look great. You look like you could be back in your 40s again.
Thank you.
That's all I'm saying.
Thank you. That's for me a huge compliment. For somebody else, maybe an insult.
Well, I'm complimenting George R. R. Martin and not anybody else. So
that's what I like to hear.
Good news.
So, I know that based from watching the television show, there's a fantasy, there are dragons, there's deceit and political intrigue, but the fans did not quite like how it panned out in the ends there. So what changes have you made for this new version of the book?
Well, I've been thinking a lot about what people do like, you know, and something that I liked while I was not writing the books, my favorite thing to do is go to Clippers games, sit on the court side, watch Clippers. And then, you know, given all the coronavirus situation, I haven't been able to do that. So I thought, well, what if in the books we could still go to Clippers games? So instead of whatever Arya did in the show, Arya is going to infiltrate the NBA bubble.
Okay.
I remember when she was walking around the Red Keep with ash on her face after seeing everything destroyed. Are you saying that there's a chance we may be able to see Arya with double overtime confetti on her face walking through a celebratory crowd?
I am saying that. Yeah, no spoilers. I don't want to give any spoilers. I want people to buy the book. But instead of going to the Red Keep, Arya is going to infiltrate the NBA bubble and become the starting point guard for the Los Angeles Clippers.
Okay, hold on. So I have a question for you, George. And I say this. Wow, I thought that was a sweater vest. Mm-mm. So I say that. I lost my toothpick.
That's a compliment for George R. R. Martin. But maybe for someone else, that would not be a compliment.
That's true.
I have no knowledge of your book series or of your television show that's based off your book series, so I'm not qualified to ask on that, but I do have one question. I know you said no spoilies.
Yeah, no spoilers.
Are you writing this live based off of the actual events of what's going on in the NBA bubble?
I am, yes. So what obviously what happened today, we saw the Milwaukee Bucks decide to cancel their games, which I'm actually, I'm a fan of that. And I should say, go Bucks.
That's a great idea. I do support that. It's very good. It's and very then, solid the Clippers strike by the players.
Maybe even going to scrap the whole rest of the season. And that's interesting too. I'm curious to see what happens with that. But regardless, Aria's getting into the bubble and we'll see what happens. If the NBA season doesn't happen, well, we can follow what she does, just living in Disneyland by herself.
I do like that as a backup plan. Okay. If current events in the real world cause the story of Aria and the NBA to not be as delightful as it sounds on
it
paper,
sounds delightful though, doesn't it?
She can just go to Disneyland.
Disney World.
Disney World, excuse me.
Whichever one's in Orlando, I don't
Disney
know.
Disney World.
That's World. World's got infinite lands of imagination. Plus, you're in the Orlando area. You get Kissimmee, St. Cloud. Oh, man, you could go hit Universal Studios. You could hit Islands of Adventure. You could go to all of the places from, like, the movie The Florida Project. Mini golf courses. You could go to Destin. There's a lot of places you could take young Aria in a Floridian landscape.
Yeah, I'm excited. But, you know, Arya's not the only one whose story is going to change. I've also decided that Podrick, instead of just being a sidekick to Brienne of Tarth, Podrick Payne is going to leave and go join the Democratic Party. And he's going to join the ticket with Biden and Harris. And, in fact, he's going to take over for Biden as presidential candidate. And people are going to think, well, I don't want to vote for Podrick Payne to be president. Great. He doesn't either. He wants to be vice president. Kamala's going to be president. It's going to be a cool book.
Don't you think people will get upset by the fact that Podrick is such an innocent character who really limited the damage he did, that he will, by contrast, be a liability when posed on stage with any of the other Democrats?
You know, the main function of Podrick joining the ticket is just to get Kamala to be president instead of Biden.
Interesting. So there's some characters that I feel like other characters I feel like didn't get the proper send-off.
Oh, sure. Who would you like to see?
Bran was a character who kind of was promised fanciful powers, but in the end he mainly just sat there until he was appointed king of everything. Mm-hmm. How does his fate look like in this new version?
Well, I'm glad you asked. Bran is actually going to be Bernie Sanders, but from the 60s. So young Bernie Sanders.
In the photo where he's being carried away?
Okay. That's the one. That's him.
Heavy activist Bernie Sanders. I like
activist
that.
Activist Bernie Sanders. And instead of letting Daenerys go evil, because nobody liked that, Bran is going to talk Daenerys into being good, because Bernie in the 60s is great at talking to people. Bran is great at talking to people. So Bran's going to convince Daenerys not to be evil, and Daenerys is going to be Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
My gosh.
Are you just writing a political fan fiction?
No, that's interesting. I'm expanding beyond basketball and politics. I decided that Missandei, I think, is an underused character. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Missandei, when she dies, it's very sad. But instead of her dying, what if she was on an iPad instead of page 247? There was just an iPad in there doing a version of the WAP video with Megan Thee Stallion.
Is this for The Late Show with Stephen Colbert or Jimmy Fallon?
No, this is for the book. The Winds
Stephen Colbert. No, Stephen Colbert and Jimmy Fallon would never do comedy as good as that on either of their shows.
I wasn't sure if this was a segment as part of a larger late night program or just a self-produced video.
Oh, I see. Yes, there is a Colbert Report revival in chapter 247. But
All right, I can get behind that.
Yes.
So wait, is this like a deep fake?
No, it's real.
It's real.
It's fiction.
Well, it's fiction, but so is a deep fake is like a deep fiction. But is it like did you map the actress's face for Missandei, or did you take the real Missandei? Not familiar with the books. I don't understand the right way to phrase this question, and we're running out of time. So
I totally understand it. So what I've done is I wrote to Megan Thee Stallion and Cardi B. Cardi B said she didn't want to have anything to do with it. She's busy. She's focusing on politics, which is nice of her to do. But Megan Thee Stallion said she needed a distraction from the time she got shot. So she was on board. She and Missandei, the actress who plays Missandei, whose name I forgot because turns out George R. R. Martin, not great with women. I don't remember her name. Sorry. But the two of them, they're going to make the video together. They're actually filming tomorrow.
Oh,
interesting. Well, you've dropped this exclusive here on our seminar. It's only right that we provide you with some guidance as to selling this only existing copy of the old book. And I'm assuming an outline, or are you promising a finished copy of the new book as well?
Well, I'm just selling the old book.
Okay.
This is the finished copy of The Winds of Winter as seen on TV. And that's for sale because I'm rewriting a completely new story. So I don't
Looks like you could sell that for a good amount of money. You know, if it's signed especially, you could sell it for even more. Mm. A lot of your books that are signed are selling for decent amounts on eBay. Maybe if you said something that said you respected women now, that seems like you have a problem with that. You know, we have somebody, who is it in the chat who's calling that out? Dash Gash, your books are sexist. So
I'm trying to change that. So I'm glad you gave me the opportunity to speak of that. Instead of Sansa being a Sansa, she's Legend of Korra. And instead of Brienne of Tarth, nope, I'm keeping Brienne of Tarth. She's great. And what else did I write down? Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, come on. We put AOC in there. Also, this isn't about women, but I think y'all should know Tyrion's just going to be Peter Dinklage himself.
Fascinating. He's a great actor.
I still don't understand, but, I mean, you're saying a lot of words that I like to hear, and I think that's all I really need at the end of the day.
I wish you luck on this. I imagine if you, you know, have a little photo of yourself there wearing your Clippers sweater vest / jersey, you'll be able to catch all four quadrants of HBO watchers, literature lovers, Clippers fans, and sweater vest enthusiasts. And that
isn't
might
a jersey just a sweater vest for athletes anyway?
I don't know. I'm not a stand-up comedian. I cannot dissect that beyond a cursory glance.
That actually, your mentioning of HBO reminded me, Chapter 47 is the show I May Destroy You.
Interesting. Is it a novelization of the show?
It's another iPad stuck in the middle of the book.
This is going to be a fat book.
Interesting.
Oh, yeah. There's more than three iPads. I can't tell you what's on the other two. No spoilers.
Well, this is fascinating, and I wish you luck. I'm going to watch this listing just so I can keep track of it. I will not be bidding myself, so no promises there. But you will have us watching, and I hope that you've cleared off all copyright questions involved in the production of this new version. And,
I sure have.
That's all I need to hear. It's the honor system.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I mean, I asked Megan Thee Stallion, she's on board. I asked Michaela Cole, she said, I don't understand, but then she was on board. And that's all.
Okay.
The NBA might be a problem.
I feel like the
give
NBA
them a couple
players
of days to get back to you, I'd say.
Yeah, they're
also
busy. They're busy.
We'll just wait to see what happens. You know, maybe if life can imitate art, then art can imitate life right back.
That's right. Oh, I forgot to say, I already mentioned Bran. LeBron James is Jon Snow now.
Oh, yeah. Fascinating. I feel like he hasn't done anything of that level since he was in...
Vice versa.
Yeah.
I was just saying vice versa. Uh-huh. Well, we've gone way over time on a bit that I don't understand. but
no, not a bit. It's real.
It's real.
I know. A bit of knowledge that I don't understand. Mm-hmm. A bit of understanding that I do not have. But George, Mr. Martin, sir, Mr. Rur, please, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you both for the help and for having me.
Take care now, my friend.
Golly. Yeah, I loved so much about what he said, even though I've never read a good Game of Thrones and I never intend to.
Well, I've been in a room while someone tried to read one.
Oh, how did that go?
I think they got two pages in. Speaking of two pages in, we are two students into this wonderful, delightful program. We have two more, which we are excited to bring on here.
Actually, it looks like we might have three more.
Interesting.
Our next group is a pairing. Before we bring them on, we should plug our donation for this week, the National Birth Equity Collaborative. Donate there if you haven't donated yet.
Yes, you'll see it there in the corner, tinyurl.com/birthequity. Once you get to that page on the drop down, please select National Birth Equity Collaborative.
Well, we got a duo coming in next, so let's go ahead and meet our next pair of students, Natasha and Blair.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi there.
Am I speaking to Natasha or Blair? Oh, Natasha.
Yes, hello. Me, Natasha. Blair. Blair, they're done talking about Game of Thrones. Sorry, let me get my sister. I'm sorry.
It's all good.
He just gets kind of cranky.
Yeah, no worries.
What the fuck do you want? We're on the show. What? I'm sorry.
Is your sister not want to participate in the show?
She does. No, I don't. Yes, she does. She does. We have something really cool that we want to show you. We have to pay rent. Okay. Don't forget. Yes. We have something that we want to show you. We think it's probably really valuable and we're just rearing to go with you guys. So thank you for having us.
Yes, of course.
All right. So what do you got for us?
Great. Our grandma gave us this.
Oh my gosh.
She said that she sank on a ship and she like got drawn and stuff, and it was from like one of her true loves. It was our grandma's, so it means a lot to us. She got it at a garage sale. No, it was actually our grandma's, seriously. Do you know anything about how much this would cost?
First off, it is a very beautiful item. The way it dangles in your hand is indicative of the quality. It sort of has a hang between each of the crescent loops there. I like that.
Right. You can tell bad jewelry does not hang. Bad jewelry keeps its form.
Okay. That sounds good. I don't know what he's talking about. You guys are professionals, right? You know that it hangs.
We do.
You know.
I'm looking up counterfeit jewelry right now, and all the counterfeit jewelry that I'm seeing here. Actually, sorry, it auto-corrected to copper jewelry, so you'll have to bear with me for a minute.
No, that's a common mistake.
Tom, if you can, please limit your mistakes. I'm starting to feel a little insecure about. I feel like we don't want to give Blair more ammunition. I feel like she's really.
Listen, I'm in a new location. All right, I didn't know what was going on. All right, but I'm looking at look, I've got this is a counterfeit necklace I found. It literally says it right in here: counterfeit turquoise choker necklace. This does not look good. This does not look like something I would wear, and it also looks like it's molded. They've got the earrings in a neck. Like that's not how it's not how jewelry works, right?
That makes sense.
You clearly understand how jewelry is supposed to hang. Which is perfect for selling a rare jewel such as that.
Yeah, no, totally. That makes sense.
So
thank you.
Your grandmother sank with the ship. I'm presuming.
Yes, it was our grandma. Yes, it was our neighbor. She got it at a garage sale. It was inherited, and it's very expensive.
For some reason, I feel like I'm 15 years old in a classroom, and I feel very unsure of myself. Like anything I say may be judged, and I don't know what to do with this feeling.
Right. That's kind of how I'm feeling. I'm also getting it. Somebody in the chat, we have people in the chat saying that it's definitely the Titanic necklace, but also that I wouldn't wear that, which is accurate, but feels kind of hurtful. I don't know why I feel hurt. Maybe that's my own bullshit I'm bringing into this.
Can I talk to Blair for a second?
Victor Krakobain says Blair is mean. Blair, what do you think about that?
She is so funny. She is so freaking funny.
So Blair, I was just curious, Blair, what kind of bands do you like?
You still care about what bands people like?
I don't know. I don't like bands
Seriously?
Anymore.
Blair, what do you like?
What I don't know. I like defunding the police. I don't know. I like caring about things that actually matter in the world. I don't know. And I like dogs. Like, what kind of question is that?
It's a legitimate question. You seem to be off put by the fact that somebody might like music, so I wanted to see what your interests were.
Okay, well, you can You guys are so... Did you take improv classes? You guys are funny.
I've overheard improv classes next door.
I couldn't afford the improv classes here at the Learning Annex.
They're 400...
Yeah, well, maybe you should take an improv class. Okay.
They're expensive at places besides... I've heard that the Pack Theater offers great deals on classes, but I've never been able to afford one.
Yeah, that sounds really hard.
If I were to take an improv class, would Blair think that was cool?
Yeah, I think Blair would think that's cool, right, Blair? No.
I was just—it was just a joke. I would never take an improv class because I'm not a loser. So,
hey, Blair. What if we took the funds that were sold from this necklace? Grandmother owned or otherwise.
It was our neighbors, yeah.
Whatever. What if it was used, the funds were used to a cause that would help an issue you lacked?
Okay, yes, it was used for, what?
If it was used for an issue that you lacked. Like if it supported, say, an organization that was actively working to defund the police.
Okay. Instead of haha make 'em up?
Or she, rant.
By that, she means comedy. She's just really dry.
No, I get that.
One time when
rent,
I...
Do you guys... If you guys live together, then if you don't need to worry about paying rent, then we can just get out of here right now, I think.
No, we have to pay rent.
Blair, how are you going to pay rent this month?
None of your beeswax.
That's funny.
She's a nanny. She's a really good nanny. She's like, so good with kids.
I love kids too. That's so cool that you like make your money and stuff. Like you got a job and like I don't know. Like one time I was like, because I have a car and I like drive around sometimes and I listen to cool music and it'd be cool to be like to like go hang out or something. Instead
Michael,
of,
you're playing right into her hands.
I'm not
also, you're married.
What?
You're in a relationship or something, right? What happened with you and Jacqueline Bonnet Carter?
Oh, yeah, she's old news wax.
I thought this was a show where you get money. It is. It is a show. It's a show where you get money. Okay. It's just, I'm sorry.
I could like steal a bunch of alcohol and meet you wherever you're babysitting. Like I know I'd get in trouble, but like. You seem cool, so I would do that.
Cool. I'll why do you keep need it in to, mind.
Why do you need to steal alcohol?
Just because I like to be bad, too, okay? Like, I flipped off a guy. He wasn't a cop, but he seemed disturbed by it. So
you are so fucking lame. You are so fucking lame.
No, Michael knows what... He knows what fuck 12 means. Right? You know what fuck 12 means, right, Michael?
Oh
yeah, that's
God.
Like when the guy has 12 fingers.
Yeah.
And then, like, the girl's like, I don't know, man. Like, I just think everything's crazy, and I'm like, I just want to be, like, chill, you know? Like, I try not to worry about all that stuff that, like, the other guys worry about. I'm just like, cool. I just like to, I'm just hanging out, you know, basically.
Listen, all right, listen.
I have a boyfriend.
Natasha, that's cool. Blair, it's, look, Michael's gotten clearly very flustered. We do have to move along. I'm so sorry. I will say this. I believe that you can sell that for a lot of money, but you both need to agree on it because if you sell that, and it becomes an unintentionally haunted atom with the negative energy that's going between you two, then you could be held liable. I have been victim of that before. I one time I sold a saddle from a horse that died, and I did not tell anybody in the listing that it was from a dead horse, and it all came back to bite me. So make sure you get all of your ducks in a row as far as what you're going to do with that item before you sell it.
Okay, that makes sense. Thanks for nothing. Thank you for wasting our time.
Thank you for wasting our time. You're a real pleasure.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Fuck off.
Thank you. Okay. Next time.
This is my own lighter. I like own it myself, so.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Bye. See you. Bye.
See you later.
Michael. You know, Jacqueline had better not be watching this.
Man, just shut up, dude. I was just like trying to play it cool. I was like trying to play it cool. You're acting like all 13 years old. Like you just wanted to joke around. And I was like just being normal, you know?
Michael, we have like a job to do.
Yeah, of course. I'm just saying, like.
Did you start leaning back further in your chair? Did you like unlock the thing on the chair that lets you lean further back like a cool guy?
Yeah, right.
You know, women don't think you're cool because of how far you can lean back in a chair.
Nah, man, I was on varsity for 2 years.
What team on varsity? What activity?
Baseball.
You were a varsity baseball player?
For 2 years.
Which two?
Freshman and sophomore year.
Oh, they got rid of you for the second 2 years.
I got demoted. Oh.
Well, I also hope that eBay salespeople weren't watching that because people are talking about stealing. People want to teach you how to steal from eBay in the chat.
Oh my God, I don't know. Sorry, Tom. I got transported to my high school years there for a second. But I am better now. What it is about a very frustrated, judgmental young women that just takes me to a place.
I get that. All of the women who I've ever dated in my life up until very recently have been women who seem to have an active disdain or dislike for me. And it used to feed me. And I thought it fed my soul for a little bit. And then I realized I cannot allow myself to engage in any sort of romantic relationship with anybody like that.
We still have one more student, but I'm going
to tell
you.
We're already over time.
The fastest real story ever. We went to Knott's Berry Farm 1 year.
Who's we?
My eighth grade class.
Oh, okay.
All and right. All the other boys, they went on the dinosaur ride, which is a slow kids ride, with the girls so that they could like make out on the ride. And
classic.
Me and this little other guy named Alan, we just sat on a bench eating French fries while all the boys and girls went to make out on the dinosaur ride.
That's a great story. And I'm glad that you felt vulnerable enough to tell me that. Yeah. Dash Gash, you're right. Let's bring on the next student. By the way, let's bring on for the final guest. We got Teresa. Teresa, sorry to keep you waiting so long. Are you there?
Yeah, sorry. Hi.
No.
It's pronounced Teresa.
Teresa. Did I get it better that time?
Yes. Thank
you.
Okay,
good. I have trouble with the R's sometimes.
That's okay.
It's resplendent that you've joined us on this evening. I thank you for being here, Teresa. How can we help you on this evening?
So, as you know, I'm a philosophy major and I'm a freshman, so I'm still learning. I found out recently that my grandma also studied philosophy,
okay.
Which is very cool. So the whole family from my sister's quinceañera, we went down into the basement to look through like all the things we had there, and we found a lot of philosophy artifacts that my grandma had collected over her life.
Fascinating.
So, So one of them is a bust of Nietzsche, of Friedrich Nietzsche. Here's the bust. And I was wondering if you could tell me how much this would go for.
Can you hold that a little closer to the screen for me, please?
As we all know, he was an Übermensch. So you can see his veins of when he worked out in Germany in the 19th century.
Does look very veiny in this bust. Is that a goatee of some sort that he has there?
It looks like a beard.
It's like his famous Friedrich Nietzsche mustachio.
Oh.
Interesting.
I can't even recognize what a mustache looks like anymore ever since I shaved mine off.
Was Friedrich Nietzsche, he was known for having a pronounced divot in the top of his skull?
Not that I'm aware, but my grandma was really into collecting, all sorts of strange artifacts. And one thing that concerned the family was, even though Nietzsche said God is dead, before she passed away, we would always hear our grandma screaming God, like God, God. So we don't know where that comes from.
We know she's religious. How would you describe her general demeanor? Tight and wound, or relieved and glowing?
I would say maybe not put it on your face.
Why?
Oh, because
why not,
of the
Tom?
Dust from the basement?
Yeah, let's go with that.
Tom, I feel like you're sending out some signal that I'm not picking up on. What I see here is what Teresa's described, is a bust of Nietzsche. And you said this is just one of a couple you have?
Oh, yeah. So like I said, my grandma was a philosophy enthusiast. We weren't sure who this was yet. First, we thought it was the pirate from Pirates of the Caribbean.
Jack Sparrow.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
It turns out it's a bust of Descartes, the French philosopher from the 17th century, who in my grandma's diary, we found that he wrote, "I come, therefore I am."
Interesting. So your grandma kept notes alongside each of these.
Yes. Your previous question, whether she was wound up or like a free lady, she was always wound up Monday through Thursday and suddenly became very different Friday, Saturday, Sunday, the days when she didn't go to church.
Now, so she went to church multiple days. Wait, she didn't go to church on Sundays.
No, because she, like I said, she likes Nietzsche, and Nietzsche, said God is dead. So she had conflicting thoughts. She went to church Monday through Thursday, but not the other days.
Was Descartes persecuted in his time for his offbeat philosophies? Judging by this bust, it looks like he may have been hung multiple times around his neck, each one causing a divot or ridge.
Oh my God, I never thought about that, but you're right. He definitely looks like he was very hung multiple times.
What's up with their faces? There's no faces on either of these busts. Is that an artistic choice?
We are not sure. I believe it's so that we can put our own thoughts and feelings into them.
Are those the only two?
We found one more, but I don't like this one that much. As a philosopher student, I'm not a fan of the Greek philosophers, but here's a Socrates.
How interesting.
We have the set of three. So I wonder, with a complete set of three, how much these busts would go or in eBay.
He looks like that just got out of a Greek salon.
Yes, this wasn't live, but we actually were discussing Greek philosophers and philosophy in general. So this is very on topic for us. I'm very excited to see these, especially so close to your face. For the third one, for Socrates.
Socrates.
I noticed that when you hold him up to the light, there's a transparency effect.
Right.
And this, I say, this is perhaps to suggest that a lot of the truths that he elucidated were not inventions on his part, but he had the clarity of mind to observe and discern the poetics, God's nature, and such and so forth.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
This is, might seem like an out-of-the-box question, but did your grandma masturbate with these?
Oh, no. She never even had sex that I know, only to make my mom and five other children.
Okay, well.
That's a lot of sex.
That's six times. That's not a lot for an old lady.
Oh, well, Michael, go ahead.
I want to apologize. That was uncalled for, and it was quite a leap that I took there. I'd like to walk it back, if I may.
I actually would like to further this line of questioning a little bit. So, where in your grandma's possessions did you find these?
In the basement, with all her boxes of, like, giant, this size, giant rosary beads.
Interesting. How many rosary beads were on each, you'd say?
It's weird because usually rosary beads have like 10 times 5. I think it's like 50 for all the Hail Marys you have to do.
Yeah.
These ones were like, I don't know, 4, 5, 6. Maybe okay. It's like, you know, an incomplete rosary.
Some people pray so hard that they will lose beads from the grocery.
Sometimes that's why you don't do your rosary in the grocery.
They just fall right under the racks. Tom, you've had this thing inside of you that you would like to express that hasn't come out. And I would like to give you an opportunity to.
Oh, this one's so cute. Sorry. I just like, he's cute. Tom, go ahead.
I'm trying to figure out a delicate way to phrase this in a way that does not harm your chances of selling your grandmother's wares on eBay. Do any of those hit? So I've read a little bit of philosophy, right? And I know that even though your grandma sounds like she goes to church, though she also believes in Nietzsche's philosophies and that God is dead, she has a God spot, right? Like a G spot, like if we want to call it that. So do you think that these busts helped achieve her reaching her G spot?
I don't know what to say to that, is that that may be the case. If you think studying philosophers that don't like God is a way to get closer to God, that may be so. As for the G-spot question, these guys, when the family found them, they were kind of brown with rust, I guess, from being stored for so long in the basement. So I washed them, and now they're all clean.
Now, Okay. Surely that was rust that had accumulated.
I have a question. Do you think this could be sold as puppets for like a theater show for children, now that many teachers are going to teach through Zoom? This could be like a little, like, I don't know, family.
We don't have a good track record with puppets on this show. I wouldn't even say puppet again. You might get attacked. Tonight's been a weird night for puppets.
By puppets? Okay.
Puppets are scary than you think.
One of those puppets, if activated by a supernatural force, may sneak up in you without you realizing it, and it can cause some antics.
You may be able to tell if these actually are haunted, in which case you're going to be able to sell more money for them. Have any of them exhibited any sort of shaking, like a vibrating with energy of some kind?
No, I believe these were pre-battery powered technologies.
Well, they might do it on their own, even if there's no batteries involved in busts and vibrating.
If you go like that.
No, okay. Well,
that looks like
tried.
She's a maniac.
I'm just trying to help you sell as much as you can, but listen, I got nothing further, Michael. I think that it's best we probably wrap up and you give this fine young lady, Teresa, a little bit of advice on what to do with these busts or things that help bust.
They look like ice pops, so I just want to kind of chew them sometimes.
I don't believe you're supposed to chew. I would like you to list these, and this is untraditional, separately, rather than as a trio.
Oh.
Just because I feel like you want to maximize the amount of pleasure that the world gets from these busts, and you want them to go to three different people rather than having them all stuck in one person's home.
But they're brothers.
I will say, also list them under Godspot Stimulation. There's 55,000 different listings on eBay for that, and it looks like there are a lot of other busts here.
This is a virtual portrait of my grandma. I don't know why her mouth hole was made this big by the artist.
Or that square.
That's her mouth, exactly.
I've never seen a square mouth like that.
And like I told you before, you tell me how much they should go for, even though I said my grandma only had sex six times, I was referring to vaginal sex. She did have anal every day, five times a day.
Oh,
interesting.
Like a Muslim prayer, five times a day.
I'm gonna step
That's
in there.
That's rude.
I'm gonna step in
I'm
there.
I'm just saying.
Tom,
I'm just saying based off
Tom,
of a numerical situation.
Okay. There are a lot of things that happen more than once a day.
Are there a lot of things that happen exactly five times a day?
Yes.
Name three. If you love things that happen five times a day so much.
The bell.
I can name three.
Go for
Let's
it.
Let's do it.
Nietzsche, Descartes, and Socrates.
There you go, Tom.
I stand corrected, Teresa.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for bringing these on the program. I wish you
please
luck.
Please kiss them. They like to be kissed. Kiss.
I'll blow a kiss to each and every one of them.
I will too.
One.
One.
Two.
And Ubermensch.
Three.
Thank you.
Take my toothpick.
Tonight's seminar began with a supernatural murder, and it's ended with a delightful, very progressive trio of clearly erotic.
Those were clearly erotic. Yeah. I didn't want to get Teresa's image of her grandmother dashed in her mind.
It took me a while to catch on, to catch up to it, but once I imagined what they could do other than be busts, it was hard to unsee.
Oh, those things look like they could bust all right.
Now I understand
talking
that
about Chisholm. Oh, she's still here.
Thankfully, I'm actually glad that happened because I don't feel comfortable with just two males on screen having sex talk. So it was nice to thank you very much for that interruption. This has been our seminar this evening. I'm glad you were able to hang out with us. I know we went a little bit over time. I assure you that...
Us go over time? Get out of town. No way.
From here on out, we will no longer go over time, as we do respect this digital real estate that we're being given by the San Antonio Learning Addicts and their television station. So next week, join us on Wednesday, whatever the day is in September. September 2nd at 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Before you do that, go on Instagram and follow us at PowerSelling101.
Mm-hmm. Or Twitter.
Twitter as well. And remember, before you can sell what must be sold, you must heal what must be healed. You must dream what must be dreamed. You must laugh what must be laughed. You must tell what must be told. You must connect to the ever-loving presence of the sail energy in this world.
Have you been holding that up the whole time to say that little speech?
This was my reminder to give that speech at the end.
All right.
Thank you, everyone in the chat, for joining us. We hope to see you next week. Thank to all our students who joined us. Tom, my Michael, boy.
My powerful salesman, thank you.
Once we go offline, I want to tell you more about my book that I've been reading.
Oh, all right. I always love hearing about your book.